Hi everyone and welcome back to my channel. Today I'm going to be doing a book recommendations video based on the word ice. So it's a very winter feeling type of video. Or at least that was my intention, but things aren't, things will fail. You'll see, you'll understand, because I had three books in mind that have the word ice in its title. And I was so excited to recommend them. But then I realized that one of them is not translated into English. So I can't really recommend that. And so I tried to find a replacement with a book that has snow in the title. So at least it'd be very wintry. Because you can see I even have my Christmas tree up, right? Winter feeling. You know, these are the vibes that I'm trying to give out. But the French book, although it has been translated into English, it's not available unless you go via eBay, because it was translated in 1954. So the direction of this video is will veer, but I'm just going to recommend all of the books anyway. So if you can read French or you feel like going on an adventure and trying to find the older books, then maybe you can do that, and maybe that'll add to the feeling of, I don't know, adventure, like I just said. Let's just repeat what I just said. So yeah, I am going to start with the two books, though, that are available in English and were part of the initial three-book recommendations with the word ice in the cover. So we're going to start with an absolutely beautiful one. That is The Ice Palace, and this is a Norwegian author, so I'm not going to be able to pronounce the name of the author, but Tarjei Vesaas. But yeah, this is a Norwegian author, and look how beautiful this cover is. I absolutely love it. I think it's just stunning. And this book is also beautiful and stunning. And I'm going to read the blurb on this because I just think it's well done, and I don't know if I could do any better. So let me read it. The Skoll children call it the Ice Palace, a frozen waterfall in the Norwegian fjords, transformed into a fantastic structure of translucent walls, sparkling towers, and secret chambers. It fascinates two young girls, lonely Un and lively Sis, who strike up an intense friendship. When Un decides to explore the Ice Palace alone and doesn't return, Sis must try to cope with the loss of her friend without succumbing to a frozen world of her own making. This book is... It's simple. It's just the story of two girls and their friendship, a friendship that you can read a little bit more into. I certainly did. I think there's definitely a lot left up to interpretation between the relationship, but it's a very simple story of a relationship built on this incredibly beautiful but cold and icy landscape. And the imagery is just absolutely stunning. This book is one of those books you're not reading for plot, you're reading for the landscape and for the scenery. And it's absolutely breathtaking. The description of the frozen waterfall, the so-called Ice Palace, is just, it takes your breath away. And the haunting images that come out of it are just unforgettable. And so it's just one of those books that just, it's just transcending. It's just absolutely, just really, really stunning, very, very beautiful. I mean, fantastic translation. And this is definitely a beautiful book to read in the winter if you're into seasonal reading. So yeah, just oof. And it reminds me that I really need to read another book by this author. His book, The Birds, sounds very intriguing to me. And I think it'll be one of the next books I order and try to find and read, because I was just absolutely blown away by this book, The Ice Palace. Just, oh, look at that cover. It's just so gorgeous. So on that same sort of notion, and all these books are quite short, so it's really, really good. You can easily read them very quickly. But the next book I wanted to suggest that has ice in the title because the cover, the title is just called Ice by Anne Cavan. And this goes in a totally different direction from the previous book. The previous book is beautiful and subtle and quiet, and it really reflects on a cold, cold and solid backdrop and scenery to really push the emotions of the book through, while this book relies on chaos. This book is absolute chaos. And once again, I'm going to read to you the blurb, because there's no way I can describe this by myself. So, in a frozen apocalyptic landscape, destruction abounds, great walls of ice overrun the world, and secretive governments vie for control. Against this surreal yet eerily familiar broken world, an unnamed narrator embarks on a hallucinatory quest for a strange and elusive glass girl with silver hair. He crosses icy seas and frozen plains, searching ruined towns and ransacked rooms, desperate to free her from the grips of a tyrant known only as the Warden, and save her before the ice closes all around. A novel unlike any other, Ice is at once a dystopian adventure, shattering the conventions of science fiction, a prescient warning of climate change and totalitarianism, a feminist exploration of violence and trauma, a speculative literary dreamscape, and a brilliant allegory for its author's struggles with addiction, all crystallized in prose, glittering as the piling snow. Yeah. I can't say anything better than that. I almost can't really contribute more than that. It's a really fascinating book. You as it says, you have this unnamed narrator, this man who's searching for this glass girl, and there's so many like interpretations you can take from the book. It really reads like a Kobo Abe, where a book starts very straightforward and you kind of have a mission, and you have an unnamed narrator just like Kobo Abe does in his books, and slowly as the narrator tries to reach for his goal, and the closer he gets to it, the further the goal gets pushed away, and then sort of the surroundings and the landscape starts to crumble about him and creates this level, this like just very stressful level, this stressful frenzy, and as I mentioned again, a paranoia that really makes the narrator and the reader question reality versus the mind's, you know, unstable state. And it's really, really just a fascinating read. As I mentioned, you definitely have a dystopic feel and a very science fiction feel, but it's very much a book for people who say they're not into science fiction. It's very much a book for people who prefer what they call literary fiction, because it really delves into, again, these ideas of climate change, trauma, abuse, sort of what's real, what's not real, and it really just explores all these topics in a really, really fascinating way. But it is incredibly chaotic. It's not an easy book in terms of emotion because it's not straightforward. It always, the narrative will take you in one direction and then it suddenly pulls you into another direction. And when you have also this frenzy of an ice world that is just coming towards you as fast as it can, and you're trying to flee that at the same time as you're trying to save another person, it's absolutely fascinating. Really, really great. Definitely, if you're a Kobo Abe fan like I am, this is a fantastic book to read. And so yeah, Ice is just, it's a weird one, but it's, I really, really, really enjoy this one. Definitely recommend it. So now I am going to recommend the two books that are not readily available, just because I really do think they're beautiful books and I want people to know about them. So I'm going to do the first one that was translated into English, although it was translated into 1954, so I can't speak on its translation. Usually older translations tend to have problems, to be honest. But like I said, I read this in the original French, so I can't speak about that. But I do think if you do read French, you definitely should read this book. And that is La Neige en Deuil by Henri Troyat. Henri Troyat is a Russian French author. He's very much kind of a forgotten French author, but I quite like him. I think this is his most spectacular book. He writes quite a lot of books about World War One, not two. I believe it's World War One. And the other books I've read have been more like, yeah, the war and then romance, and has a very romance feeling. But this is just, it goes in a totally different direction from the other books that I've read about him, and it's absolutely spectacular. It has, so the French title is La Neige en Deuil, which means like the snow in mourning, and but the English translation is just the mountain. It's just the mountain. There's not really, it takes away a little bit of the romance. But yeah. So what is this about? It's about two brothers. And that's what I love about this book, is that it has a very amazing story about siblings and sibling rival and sibling love. And it's just absolutely fantastic. But again, what is the book about? It's about, one of the brothers, I need to look up the names or else I'm not going to be able to describe this very well. So the younger brother, Marcelin, goes to his older brother, Isaïe, because a plane has crashed in the top of the mountain. And Marcelin tells Isaïe, we have to go save these people. And the reason he asks his brother Isaïe is because Isaïe was once a very reputable mountain guide, especially during the winter. And although he is now retired and he's kind of a recluse from his village at this point, but Isaïe, although he wants to refuse this job because following a crash site in the middle of winter is incredibly dangerous, but his younger brother Marcelin insists that they do it. So they go off to this crash site, and it turns out that Marcelin has ulterior motives, in the sense that this plane crash was believed to be carrying very rich customers, and so Marcelin believes there will be jewelry and money to be found at the crash site, and so this creates, when his older brother Isaïe kind of figures out his younger brother's ulterior motives, it creates this huge sense of tension between the two, which you add that on top of the very dangerous winter conditions on the top of the mountain, just creates this story that's just absolutely, absolutely terrifying. And I think what's also really beautiful about this book is that it kind of plays with time a bit, and I'm not gonna say how it does that because that would kind of spoil the book. But this book, it's beautifully written. It really brings you into the atmosphere of this cold winter mountain. It beautifully portrays sibling love, sibling rivalry, envy, hate, jealousy, greed, and it really delves into the personality and the mindset of our Isaïe, and really shows us why he became a recluse and why he decided to give up the mountain, which was something he actually really, really loved. So this is an absolutely beautiful story. If you read French, I highly recommend reading this one. Again, it's very short, just like the other ones, like 120 pages, no more. Absolutely recommend it. And so this is called The Mountain in English, and before filming this video I did look it up on the internet. It is available on like eBay, it is available on ebooks, so you can buy it, but you're just not going to be able to buy it at your regular bookstore. That's all I'm trying to say with that. But yeah, this La Neige en Deuil, absolutely beautiful. Love this book about brotherhood, because brotherhood isn't really a connection, a human connection that I read all that much. So this was absolutely beautiful, fascinating read. I love this. So the other book I want to recommend, and I'm looking at my computer so I can kind of look at the blurb, is a Japanese book by Yasushi Inoue, so Inoue Yasushi. And that book is called Parois de Glace, which, and in Japanese, the title is Hyoheki. So basically, parois de glace is like just on a mountain, when you have like a shelf or wall that's just pretty much iced over. So that's parois de glace. So just a wall of ice. And basically, parois de glace is this story, again, takes place in the mountains where our two main characters, Kosaka and Uozu, go into the mountains, and Kosaka dies, and there's questions about whether or not Kosaka, so the two were connected by a rope, they fall, and then Kosaka dies, and the question is, did Kosaka cut the rope himself as a suicide to save his friend? Did the rope break, or did Uozu cut the rope himself to save himself, so that the two of them wouldn't fall off the cliff? And so the book is all about Kosaka trying to prove that he didn't cut the rope. But the thing is that it really brings up the question of honor within men, because if Kosaka proves that he didn't cut the rope, then it shows that his friend probably killed suicide, which wouldn't be reflected well upon, especially since that friend had a wife that he left behind. But obviously, if Kosaka is proved to have cut the rope himself to save himself, then that also kind of like reflects on his honor. So he's trying to defend himself while also protecting the honor of his friend. And all of this, while he has developed this romantic relationship with the wife of his friend, but he refuses to fall into those emotions in respect of his friend. So he decides to marry another woman. But obviously, when you marry someone that you're not in love with, and you just do it out of, you know, sort of a social obligation, that leads to its own problems. So it's a beautiful book with these beautiful mountain scenes and just a beautiful backdrop. I mean, I love the backdrop of mountains. I always think it's fascinating. It leads to so much. You can do so much with that backdrop, just because of the brutality and the beauty of nature, and particularly the brutality of a winter mountain. You can do so much. But then putting on top of that this idea of honor within men, honor within the sport, honor towards the mountain, honor towards those family members that have been left behind, just leads to an absolutely beautiful story. So Parois de Glace, if you can read French, I definitely recommend it. And I think if you can read Spanish, I think it's also been translated in Spanish. So there are options for the non-English readers out there. So, but apologies to the English readers, that book has not yet been translated into English. So to finish off with a book that has been translated into English, because it was originally written into English, although it's not a fiction, I thought I would end this because the last two books that I wanted to recommend but couldn't really 100% recommend, because those were about alpinism. I thought I would recommend the nonfiction In Truth and Air, because if you can't read those other two books that I recommended, you can at least get the same themes within this absolutely amazing memoir by Jon Krakauer, where he basically describes what happened in 1996 when he was part of the biggest disaster on Everest, where many people were killed, and he was part of one crew of the three crews that were involved in that incredibly horrific accident. And again, this talks about greed, poor judgment, just mistakes, bad luck, ego, definitely talks a lot about ego within man, how far man is ready to go to pursue these kind of absurd dreams when you think about it. This is absolutely amazing. This is such a page-turning read, and it really captures all of the emotion and themes of the other books, but just within a nonfiction. But this is a very narrative read. It reads so quickly. It's not dry at all. It's very just super amazing. So if you can't read those other books, I definitely recommend reading Into Thin Air by John Krakauer, which is one of my favorite nonfictions from last year. I just forgot to mention that because my friend was borrowing it at the time, so I didn't have it in front of me. But yeah, absolutely beautiful, beautiful book. So yeah, those are the books that I wanted to recommend today. I really hope you enjoyed this video, and I will see you guys next week. Bye.